I came into the fellowship. I was very fortunate to be able to be a 2018-2019 fellow when I was still sort of an early career faculty member. And at the time, the research that I had done up until the point that I became a fellow was not in any way related to the scholarship of teaching and learning. It had nothing to do whatsoever with any kind of access and equity, right? I'm a behavior analyst and I just focus on the organism. What does the organism do and how can we affect the organ? That's it. Being a fellow completely radically transformed my research agenda. And so my work is still, you know, at both the individual and systems level of analysis. Like, how do we have individual decision makers? What decisions do they make within the moment? How do their decisions impact the system? And how do we design the system to better support or influence the choice of the individual within the system? But it's dramatically different in that my work at its heart has changed from how do I get you to do the thing that I want you to do, to how do I work and use my knowledge to radically dismantle this oppressive system that is forcing you to be something that you are not, and make the system better for all of its users.
Thinking about this, really in terms of, there wasn't one project particularly, but at the time I was in the fellowship, certainly the work was focused more on some of those early efficacy perception studies, working with students, working with faculty, trying to create that evidence base for the practice anyway that was happening in terms of OER adoption was still a relatively new thing. It was, not at the level of awareness that things are now. And so there was a need to do that work. But, I would say in the years since, certainly the most obvious example would be the work with folks like Catherine Cronin and Mahabali working on the social justice framework for open educational practices. So building on the work of Cheryl Hodgkins and Williams and Henry Trotter, we're really trying to articulate how we can think about justice in terms of yes, redistributive, recognitive, and representational justice, but also along its economic, social, and political dimensions when it comes to broader forms of open educational practices. So, and I say this in part because it was really about as the movement gathered more steam and adherence, there was a real risk of harm being perpetrated with the very best of intentions by inattention to elements like that. So I think that's maybe the most obvious project for me.
Was to integrate open pedagogy in all of our first year study classes. So we had materials that students had bought previously. We wanted them to play a role in doing some work and developing their own first year reader to use instead of that. So that was really for diversity and inclusion. We wanted more student voices to be present. We wanted them to feel included. We wanted that to be the material they were using that previous students had used or created, and then them to keep on adding to that. So that's gone really well. We're still doing it now. I was in the 1920 cohort. And so we're on like second version of that open pedagogy book right now. And the second project during that period of time, we moved our entire campus to a free to student resources, which were OER, library resources. So that was all courses and all levels. And so we were able to do that. And that was really kind of for an access and inclusion. And equity as well, because we know we have a lot of first generation students, a lot of students that are technically in poverty. We had done some research before that said that students were avoiding purchasing textbooks. So this was done to relieve a economic pressure on them and also to kind of level that field to make sure everybody had the material with them on the start of class to be successful.
How can we infuse our learning and support our pre-service teachers' growth as anti-racist educators? It was always something that we were looking for. And what we really kind of grabbed onto when thinking about open pedagogy, that's what our project was about. Well, I say ours. It started out as mine, but it became ours. And then I was actually lucky I had three of them because I ended up doing another with Steph and another with another. But anyway, but we were really thinking about they're not only learning, but they're learning to teach. And so then the pedagogical practices that we provide to them, they're likely to take to their K-12 classrooms. So thinking about that, thinking about students, their unique lived experiences and identities that they're bringing into our learning spaces. And it just seemed like open pedagogy, and in particular, the lens that Lambert brings to that work, who talks about open pedagogy practices, bring those spaces for students to bring their identities, more inclusive and equitable practices, an opportunity to create those texts and to tell their stories instead of having those narratives told by others. So it just all kind of came together and made sense. And actually all three of the projects that Steph and I share are related to open pedagogy. And so it's been a lot of studying pre-service teachers and some actually graduate students experiences creating these resources and sharing them.
With Stacey out of her project with pre-service teachers, I was really interested in the practicing teachers who were coming back and getting their master's degree, particularly in literacy, and their experience. And so in my project, they were creating their own open source spaces. They could choose, a lot of them did blogs, podcasts, different ways of working through experiences relevant to literacy right now, which feels at this moment so full of tension in all sorts of ways, no matter what level they were teaching, whether we're talking about the books that they're using, the curriculum they're using, what different ways of thinking about reading practice itself. So they were really looking at the tension of creating a space where they could share their ideas in a way that felt safe. And so we were thinking about identities and what it means to be a teacher and put your identity out there in a way that is a helpful resource and share with others, and to bring that opportunity to students as well, who also are navigating these spaces in public schools right now, particularly.
There were at least 8 courses at the University of Georgia where 8 different faculty had adopted OER over a variety of disciplines. And that had been going on for multiple years in some cases. And so how our research addressed kind of the DEI and accessibility context was, we specifically looked at not just all the students taking these respective courses in comparison to courses that did not adopt an OER, but we also looked at sub populations within those courses and evaluated, was it a student from a low socioeconomic background? And we quantified that by looking at, were they Pell eligible? Massive gains, not just a little bit, but massive gains when an OER was adopted for those courses. And so I think it spoke volumes to, hey, an OER adoption is not just saving students money, but it's having a direct impact on their academic success and performance.
I can share a couple of things. I mean, I think it was wonderful in many ways, right? I mean, but I would say beyond the mentorship, because, you know, I was familiar with the scholarship of teaching and learning, so it wasn't really the mentorship and how to do this work that was the big piece for me, the big attraction, but it was the sense of community and affinity with the rest of the cohort. And of course, being in person at the Open Ed conferences helped a great deal. But, you know, even when particularly across cohort years, we found disciplinary affinity, for example, you know, I know for folks in psych, you know, we ended up, you know, having special issues of particular journals and working together to try and move the dial within our disciplines in a few ways. So, I mean, I love that community that we found, particularly because, especially back in the day, it was often really, you were the sort of exemplar in a way that was treated like a black sheep in many ways within your department.
One of the, I think, greatest benefits I got out of the fellowship was the fellowship, right? Those that I got to connect with, not just in my cohort, but some of the alum. I had the, I think, very fortunate opportunity, maybe being in the golden years of, because it was pre-pandemic. So we got to meet in person. We got to have a lot of that team building exercises with the welcome dinners and stuff. So I feel very fortunate and blessed to be part of that 2017-18 cohort. And in subsequent open ed conferences, we got, there was still a contingent of us that still got together And Jasmine, I'm going to throw out a blast from the past here. Like we called ourselves like the open ed group or open egg group. We went and like did a breakfast with each other. And depending on, you know, the location that you're at, you know, there's different like external trips or activities you can do in that city, right? And so we would go and do those with each other. And it's like, it's building the sense of connection, camaraderie, community that I didn't anticipate when I first was applying to the fellowship. And it also has allowed me to learn beyond just the study that I had done in my OER, because then I'm connecting with faculty or librarians or staff members at a variety of institutions all over the country, or even Canada. And like hearing about what their experiences are, how they are impacting students, or how are they impacting their campus community. And so that has also been, I believe, just only enriched my understanding and appreciation for how open education can be impacting higher education.
Don't think that it can be understated how significant the fellowship is and how transformative this can be for our science and for ourselves and for our students.
You know, as far as the fellowship in general went, I think one of the main benefits to me was, you know, it helped me learn about the open education community. I mean, going to the conferences and speaking to people, you know, I just didn't really understand, you know, the group, the community as a whole, or all the subgroups and why some people are there. I mean, you go to a conference and, you know, some people are really in the pragmatic field of, we need to save students money. I'm at a conference or I'm doing something because, you know, my school is doing this to try to benefit students in that way. Some are much more on the DEI perspective of it. And I didn't know some of those dynamics. And it's kind of hard sometimes reading just the journal articles without speaking to people to get an idea of those different subfields within the community. So being able to speak to people and be able to find out, well, what research has been done, what is kind of the leading edge of research. You know, the people in the group really knew what was out and hadn't been published. And I didn't know that. So sometimes, you know, talking to John, he'd say, you know, this, some people are researching this, but, you know, we haven't really looked at this very much, or I have a project coming up like this. It really helped me figure out as we were planning kind of what things were not only beneficial to us, but maybe beneficial to the community as a whole. So I thought that was fantastic to be able to do that. And as far as the suggestions for future individuals,